Well, in little less than a month, a vote will happen in New York, which could truly thrust Australia onto the world stage. But it comes with a rich price that some dismiss as unnecessary. Prime Minister Julia Gillard is in the Big Apple trying to secure a seat for Australia on the UN Security Council. Now, we've already invested almost 5 years and $24 million chasing it, as Eddy Meyer reports.
For Julia Gillard, this is a high-level charm offensive, seeking our seat, one of two non-permanent ones, at the top table, where all the big decisions are made.
The United Nations matters to Australia. We knew that when we joined as a founding member more than 60 years ago. The United Nations mattered to us then, and it matters to us now.
Despite our global presence and our contribution of 65,000 of our personnel to 50 UN missions, Australia has not had a seat on the Security Council since 1986. We tried and failed in the 90s. A further bid was ditched when the bill for canvassing for votes was put at $35 million. And then along came Kevin.
We have to do some more good things for the United Nations.
I think 30 years is a fair enough old wait between drinks. And I think it's time we actually got cracking and see what support we can get.
That was then, this is now, and we're still chasing that support, while Finland and Luxembourg are the front runners.
It's tight and it's close, and it'll go right down to the wire. So we've got to be there putting Australia's case. Look, we are encouraged by support we've received from many places around the world.
So on Thursday, Julia Gillard will make one final pitch during her first address to the UN General Assembly. And then she'll get her hands dirty, taking part in dozens of meetings to shore up votes. But some, namely the opposition, wonder why we're bothering, seeing it as an expensive folly, more fuel for the political bonfire.
She should be in Jakarta, not in New York, because that is where Australia's national interest is most at stake right now.
Trouble is, the Indonesian president isn't in Jakarta. He's in New York too.
This is yet another example of reckless negativity from the leader of the opposition, in complete defiance of the facts and common sense.
But the reality is the Prime Minister will probably spend more time meeting with African nations as she tries to win support for a race often likened to a prize some might consider bigger, securing the World Cup soccer.
And Foreign Minister Bob Carr has just fronted a media conference in New York. Here's a little of what he had to say about Australia's bid.
I make the point when I put Australia's case, we are not America. We are not Europe. We're a multicultural country in the between the Indian and Pacific oceans, and we've got our own perspective to put to the world. We're a middle power, creative middle power, that it might be said punches above its weight. And we haven't been on the Security Council from the mid-80s. That's our case.
Well, joining me now from Melbourne to talk more about this is Samah Hadid, a former youth ambassador to the United Nations, now National Director of the Global Poverty Project. Samah, thanks for joining us tonight. Look, even the government admits now this decision is going to go right down to the wire. What's your opinion? Do you think Australia will win a position on the Security Council?
I hope we do win a seat on the Security Council, but it is going to be a really close race. And we've come into the race rather late and well behind our competitors, Finland and Luxembourg, who frankly have a better track record as being international citizens than Australia. You know, these countries are contributing already to international peace and security, and they give more in foreign aid than Australia does.
On the foreign aid, we still do give $4.8 billion. I think it ranks us the world's 11th largest. Of course, aid alone won't be enough. What are the other key issues at play here in this decision?
This has been a real opportunity for Australia to show itself and to prove itself as a global citizen. Yes, we contribute to foreign aid, but we can do better. And frankly, we're far behind the OECD average of contributing to foreign aid. We can also do better to ensure human rights protection in our own country and abroad. And I think it's these sort of factors that will play a role in deciding the outcome. Nonetheless, it's been a great opportunity for Australia to really punch above its weight and really start seeing itself as a global citizen.
Samah, what about from a cost-benefit perspective? Julia Gillard says this is costing in the vicinity of $24 million. How will Australia benefit from a position on the Security Council?
Well, it means that we have a real voice to ensure international peace and security. It means that we can be seen as a world player and a country that has influence over international policies, a country that can meet the grand and global challenges of our time, like ending extreme poverty, like ensuring international human rights protection, and a country that sees itself as globally connected.
Samah, as we mentioned, you're a former youth ambassador to the UN. Can you give us a sense of what it's like in the UN? What's Australia in for if it does win this spot?
I think that the UN is a challenging and complex institution. I think the role it plays is, really comes down to the virtues and values of member states. And it has an important role to play in tackling global challenges like ending extreme poverty, like combating climate change and ensuring humanitarian assistance, ensuring human rights are protected. So it's an institution that needs to be engaged with if it reaches its full potential. And I think that this bid for the Security Council seat has proven that for a country like Australia, amongst other countries, it needs to remain relevant, and it needs to do so by engaging more in these multilateral institutions, not less.
Well, we'll know either way very shortly. The UN will put it to a vote on October 18. Samah Hadid in Melbourne, thank you so much for joining us.
Thanks for having me.